A husband found out about his wife's boyfriend. This is what happened to her organs. CW is a 30-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with nausea and excessive sweating. In the hospital, her heart rate went from 140 beats per minute to 40 within a short amount of time. The sudden change is abnormal and tells doctors they don't have much time left to figure out what happened. CW was married to Eric. It seemed like marriage was the best thing that happened to them. Right after the wedding, Eric's business started booming. Like CW, by just being there, brought him good luck. But work started to take up all of his time, and CW started feeling like she was only an afterthought. One day, she had a flight. Eric had promised that he would drive her to the airport. When the time came, he totally forgot because he had booked extra work during that time. Frustrated, CW got to the airport, but problems like this kept adding up. She had an uncanny way of remembering everything that Eric would say and do, and she'd take any chance to use it against him when she was unhappy. She started developing a vapor habit that Eric didn't like. He would ask her to stop, but when she realized that this got on his nerves, she started doing it more and more. Something started to brew underneath the surface, and over a few years, it came to a breaking point. One afternoon, Eric was home early. At the balcony, he looked down. He saw his wife come out of a car that he had never seen before. The driver came out and embraced CW. He couldn't believe this. He recognized the guy as her best friend's little brother, Mike. He wanted to believe that this was just a mix-up. He went into the other room so that he could try and get a hold of himself because his entire body suddenly became numb. He had noticed weird text messages from someone named Pizza Hut on her phone over the last several months. He didn't think anything was wrong then because she'd always end up with an actual pizza afterwards. But Eric found a shirt that wasn't his in their bed one evening. CW never gave a convincing response as to how it got there, but it was the same shirt that Mike was wearing now. Every response that Eric had ever received from CW recently was always combative and unhappy. He didn't know what to do, but he wasn't going to let her know that he knows. One evening, Eric and CW were at home together. It had been a while since they had a date night. Eric poured pre-mixed drinks. He was able to finally get some time away from work, and they were having a really great time. The drinks were pre-made. CW saw Eric pour them, but as they got to the bottom of the bottle, CW started noticing that each pour started to taste weirder. Eric said that it was all in her mind. It totally tasted fine, but a burning sensation started piercing through her chest as she kept drinking. She started feeling like her heart was going to explode. Face down on the couch, CW suddenly woke up. It was still nighttime and she didn't know how much time had passed. She knew what drunk felt like and this wasn't it. She ran to the bathroom and everything started to come up. Very quickly, she felt like she couldn't breathe. She tried to cry out for help, but she wasn't sure if anything was coming out. She struggled to call for an ambulance, but finally she was brought to the emergency room where we are now. At examination, the medical team finds that CW's heart rate and her blood pressure were high. Her breathing was erratic. They could smell alcohol on her breath. But when the medical team took a closer look, they noticed that her breaths were shallow. The amount of oxygen in her blood was lower than normal. She tried to tell doctors about the last thing that she could remember, but she was so panicked that words weren't really coming out of her mouth. Excess liquid was coming out of her mouth because she was producing way more saliva than normal, but she was also sweating in a way that she shouldn't be because the inside of the hospital wasn't that hot. CW was 30. She had some prior health scares before, but she was noted to be an e-cigarette user. In the hospital, her heart rate and blood pressure suddenly decrease. This quick change means that her body is responding to something, but what could it be? The most visual responses that we can observe on someone is fight or flight and rest and digest. Fight or flight can be caused by being in an immediately life-threatening situation, causing the release of adrenaline. The chemical-induced version of this is taking a stimulant. If she's salivating and having stomach movements with low heart rate and blood pressure, well, that sounds like a rest and digest response, but that's not how it started. Fight or flight response is controlled by the sympathetic nervous system, and rest and digest is controlled by the parasympathetic nervous system. These are two divisions of the same nervous system. Her initial response looked like she had ingested a stimulant, high heart rate, high blood pressure, fast breathing, but then quickly, it became as if she had taken a depressant. Slow heart rate, low blood pressure, and shallow breaths. If this trend continues, she might not be able to breathe very soon, but this gives us a better idea of what happened. When a nerve sends a signal, chemicals are released at the synapse where the nerves connect. When the signal is done, the terminal needs to be cleared, otherwise, signal is sent nonstop. But How does that happen? These chemicals can be reabsorbed or they can be broken down. The sympathetic nervous system uses noradrenaline at the end to send signals, but the parasympathetic nervous system uses acetylcholine at the end. If CW's response changed nervous systems, and these nervous systems end their signals with different chemicals, then it means that the synapses not clearing out neurotransmitters isn't her problem. But if we go earlier, we find that sympathetic and parasympathetic signals both start with acetylcholine, and the parasympathetic system keeps using it. If this is the case, then is it possible that she somehow consumed a large amount of acetylcholine? That would set off a sympathetic response at first, and the excess acetylcholine would then feed into her parasympathetic system, leaving her with an inappropriate rest and digest response. This could be plausible, except acetylcholine doesn't last very long in the body. It gets broken down very quickly. But is there another chemical that acts like acetylcholine? In the body, cells have structures that receive chemicals called receptors. Once the chemical is bound, the cells respond accordingly. Acetylcholine receptors have different subtypes. One is the muscarinic acetylcholine receptor. This takes acetylcholine, but it also takes muscarine, found in muscaria, another name for a kind of mushroom. When either chemical is bound, it causes a rest and digest response, but these receptors aren't distributed equally in the body. Muscarine doesn't have an effect on breathing, so if we look a little deeper, another subtype is the nicotinic acetylcholine receptor responding to nicotine, and this explains what's happening to CW. Nicotine is a stimulant. It acts like acetylcholine in the sympathetic nervous system to produce an effect, but in massive amounts. After it's done sending that response, the signal at the parasympathetic nervous system keeps going, producing an inappropriate, nonstop rest and digest signal. But here's another problem. Acetylcholine receptors are found in all kinds of nerves. They're found in the brain, and they're found where the nerves connect to the muscle. In the brainstem, where breathing is regulated, are nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. If a toxic amount of nicotine is present, it produces the rest and digest kind of breathing, which is a shallow breath, descending to no breathing at all, explaining one part of what's happening to CW. But there's more. In the airways, nerves send signals to the smooth muscles. When excess nicotine floods in, taking place of acetylcholine, these muscles constrict. Less space in the airway means breathing becomes harder. The brain can discharge in chaotic ways when too much nicotine is present because the nicotinic receptors get flooded. This massive release of electrical activity causes seizures, which CW was noted to have. Her muscles can no longer contract normally because nicotine has mimicked acetylcholine at the nicotinic receptors at the neuromuscular junction. Typically, when light is shined into someone's eye, their pupils will constrict so as to limit the amount of light entering in. This reflex is natural. If this reflex is absent, it means that parts of the brain aren't functioning correctly. And in CW, her pupils no longer react to light. Much earlier in her hospital admission, when her heart rate suddenly dropped, the medical team had suspected that CW was experiencing a poisoning. They took a blood sample and sent it to a lab to test because they suspected a few possible poisons. And when it returned, it reported that massive amounts of nicotine were floating around in her blood as if she had smoked 215 whole cigarettes at the same time in one puff. By this time, doctors had already put a tube down her throat so that a machine could breathe for her. They had already notified the authorities by this point. But where did this nicotine come from? At CW in Eric's house, police looked through. In trash bags in their building's dumpster, they found empty bottles of E liquid. The reason that they knew that these trash bags were from CW and Eric's household was because mail addressed to their condo unit were in that same bag. CW's vapor habit consisted of her manually filling e-cigarette devices with nicotine liquid. This was the only source of nicotine from and in the entire house. Nicotine is a natural product found in plants. It's a neurotoxin against insects, intended as a pesticide, a defense mechanism for plants. Similarly, caffeine also appears in different plants and was likely intended for the same thing. But both of these chemicals act on the nervous system in pests, where it's deadly, but also in humans, where it exerts an effect, but there's more. A kind of synthetic pesticide called an organophosphate was first made in the lab in the 1850s. In 1932, the toxic effects of this pesticide were starting to get noticed. We can understand what it does now. Do you remember that neurotransmitters need to be cleared out of the synapse when the signal is done? Well, organophosphates stop acetylcholine from being broken down. This causes a rest and digest signal to get sent nonstop. So, whereas nicotine mimics acetylcholine, where the nerve signal starts, this pesticide causes acetylcholine to never go away where the signal is supposed to end. When this was discovered, it served as the basis for nerve agents, but luckily, an antidote was found shortly after, something that might partially work for CW. When authorities questioned Eric, they presented what they found in the house, and he immediately folded. While they were drinking that night, when CW started to get tipsy, he started pouring her vape juice into the glass. When she drank some of this, she was vocal that the taste was horrible, but because she was so tipsy, she just wasn't sure. And Eric told her that he didn't think anything was wrong. But underneath, he hated her vape habit. He didn't want to see or hear her nagging anymore. He knew what she was doing outside of their marriage. Nicotine is something that could go undetected. If CW hadn't woken up in the middle of the night, the amount of nicotine that she drank would have caused her to stop breathing with no one there to help her. Within 2 hours, the body can break down half of the amount of nicotine circulating around. Eric was anticipating that she'd be knocked out for several hours, and if she were to be found after that time, no one would know to look for nicotine. CW would have stopped breathing, and the cause would be more unclear because her heart would have stopped beating, and her brain would have shown signs of damage, and of any nicotine left in her body, well, she was known to vape, so this wouldn't be anything out of the ordinary. But Eric didn't anticipate that she'd get up and throw up a large amount of nicotine into the toilet, maybe enough to prevent something permanent from happening because she was able to make it to the hospital. Nicotine poisoning is difficult because as often as it's used every day around the world, we don't know how much can be instantly lethal in humans. Most normal use of nicotine-containing products, whether it's inhalation, transdermal, buccal, or sublingual absorption, just don't come in large enough amounts for it to be acutely toxic. The conversation about acute poisoning becomes muddied when nicotine is even mentioned because it just gets lumped together immediately with tobacco. And that would be the different chronic setting. Then people will bring up how they believe that nicotine alone causes lung and mouth and throat and tongue cancer. Nicotine alone doesn't appear to do that. We know what the immediate effects of nicotine are on the nervous system and organs like the heart, because it has an effect on both the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. It creates a habit and dependency. It might also negatively impact children's brain development if they get it before their brain fully matures. Makes sense because it works directly on the nervous system. Since 2011, when e-cigarettes became prominent, until 2024, America's poison centers have had 54,000 reports of toxic e-cigarette and liquid nicotine exposures, with more than half of the cases being accidental exposures in children less than 6 years old. And these are cases that have been reported. Likely there are more that haven't been reported. And this doesn't count cases happening outside of the United States, but there are several publications about this coming out of Asian countries too. Some questionable studies say that tobacco might raise testosterone and that vaping might lower sperm count. The arguments will go on forever about this, but there's a simple rule that doesn't need a study, and it says if you don't need to put it in your body, don't put it in your body. But in this particular case, CW didn't deliberately put this amount in her body. In the hospital, she was fortunate to have a medical team that identified nicotine. There isn't a direct antidote for nicotine specifically. Doctors give CW some atropine, which is an anticholinergic given in the case of organophosphate poisoning, but atropine is known best for acting on muscarinic acetylcholine receptors, not nicotinic ones. The most important for the medical team is to make sure that the machine can breathe for her during the entire time where she can't, because excess nicotine is blocking her from doing so. But it seems like when she presented to the emergency room, it was already late for the amount that she drank, despite her vomiting. And her poisoning was identified late, especially when her pupils no longer reacted to light. There isn't much time to identify it in the first place. Her heart stopped beating in the intensive care unit, and doctors weren't able to resuscitate her. At autopsy, CW was found to have brain damage caused by low oxygen. Parts of her brain had died, and fluid started to swell in, causing the brain to push up against her skull. It's possible that some of the nerves and brain cells were also damaged because of overexcitation caused by an excessive amount of nicotine in her blood. With his confession on hand, Eric was arrested, evidence was presented, and he was sentenced. This case was given to me by a colleague from Asia. I don't think we really know what happened to the poisoner spouse. The point of this video is to teach about the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, the nicotine mechanism of action, and how it changes in the setting of overdose. Unfortunately, we don't have to go very far to find cases where couples will do something like this to each other. The chemicals are always varying, and the records can go back hundreds of years. The ones that are visible in the media are merely the ones that have been selected to be shown to you. If you've been alive for an appreciable amount of time, you've heard of at least a few times where things got life-threateningly toxic between a married couple. But I hope none of us will ever have to see anything even remotely close to this. There's a lot of things that people will somehow get into their body. It doesn't always need to be of malicious intent. Like this video about a woman who wiped back to front instead of front to back and her husband's nerves shut down, which is on Nebula first. Nebula is a streaming service that was created by creators, and it's a place where we can make and publish videos and films and originals as we see them. There's cases that I would get in trouble talking about here, but they are and will be on Nebula. We got shows, documentaries, films, plays, and Nebula is able to offer this thanks to the funding that comes from subscribers who, in addition to getting all of these, also get early access to these creators' regular videos ad-free. My chemistry buddy Niall Redd posts his videos early ad-free on Nebula. But Nebula isn't just videos that you'll find on YouTube earlier, but it's also exclusives and originals. Boomers is a feature-length documentary by Tom Nicholas exploring how the baby boomer generation became the most powerful generation in the world. It's a funny yet informative documentary where Tom traveled around the world with a crew to make it, and it just shows how much work is being put into the originals to make them on a whole other level from what we could do anywhere else. Come join us. Normally, this would be $6 a month, but if you sign up at go.nebula.tv/chubbyemu, which is the link in the description, you'll receive a big 40% off a yearly subscription, which is $36 for the year, $3 a month, and you'll get full access to the whole platform. And with your subscription, you'll get one guest pass per month, so you can share with family and friends for 7 days, and they won't need to share any payment info to enjoy. And I know this might not be for everyone, but right now, Nebula has a pay once forever lifetime subscription deal. Again, I know that's not for everybody, but Nebula is entirely owned by creators, so that lifetime subscription goes towards funding Nebula creators like me to create. There's a lot of cool projects, Nebula Originals, currently in production, and we just launched a film studio. We're growing, and we're becoming a home for independent creativity. See you there? Nebula.tv/chubbyemu. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself, and be well.